हेलो हेलो। Welcome you all to the afternoon session. Now I request today's resource person to proceed with the session. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, ma'am. Can we start, ma'am?
Yeah. Maybe another 2-3 minutes afterwards, sir, because they are joining slowly. Okay. We will remind them through WhatsApp. So we can start after 2-3 minutes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
Sir, we can start with this, sir. They will be joining slowly. We can move slowly, sir.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah, thanks. Thank you, ma'am. Yep. So, yeah, hi, everyone. So, let me go back to the slide where actually I left it. Yeah, we were discussing on this software as a service, platform as a service, as well as infrastructure as a service when we were just moving on to the cloud. So based on the need, whether are we just building a software on our own and we are just going to expose it for the others to just consume it, then we would be just going for this SaaS, software as a service. And if in case, like if we want to just consume any of the platforms like APIs or databases or any operating system, so those sort of things, like we can just go for a platform as a service. A very good example is like, if I want to just make use of the MATLAB software, I can just get into the cloud and then I can just consume those. For example, like if I want to just make use of the MATLAB Simulink software without installing it in my PC, then that is called as a platform as a service. And if I want to just install it and I want to just make use of it, that's what actually we are calling it as software as a service. If I'm just installing it, then actually like, then what actually we are, what do we call that as a software as a service means? Still like we would be just connecting via the internet in sharing our samples to the public as well as to the community forum. And in the other way around, like the MATLAB community will be like, they will be just recording our events as well as the things what actually we were just doing it in the form of actions. And as well, like we may just get some help from the common forum as well, as well as from a software standpoint, like they may also just upgrade the software. So that's where actually like we will be just using the software as a service, and platform as a service means like we can just use the complete, we can get a machine. It means like we can just make use of the Linux OS as well as Windows OS as well as without installing it in our local, kind of like a MATLAB, Simulink, whatever it might be. A complete platform, we can just get it in our local. And infrastructure as a service, like this actually deals about our VPC connections. VPC are nothing else, the virtual private connectivities. For example, like I'm just sitting at my home. If I want to just get connected with my office environment, with my office intranet, then actually like I'll be just going for via this VPC. And our company, like they made a just configured this VPC either in the cloud, in the form of an infrastructure as a service. So these are all the points. These are all some of the takeaway points which I was just touch basing when I was just closing the morning session. So let's get into the cloud now, and let's just get familiar with us with some of the cloud services that actually is required for our IoT applications. It means like, and in the other way around, like it's all about, you might be having a question, right? Question now, thinking like, I don't know anything about cloud. Okay, this was the first question which will come into mind if you are not familiar with the cloud. And the second question which will come into your mind is AWS or Microsoft's, this is actually Amazon's AWS cloud, where actually I had just taken as a sample. So similarly, like we do have a lot of cloud providers, like Microsoft has provided the Azure cloud, and Google has just provided Google Cloud Platform, and so like Salesforce has just provided, as well as lot of companies are there, VMware. So based on our own need, like our own need as well as our budget, like we will be just choosing the cloud providers, and based on that, like we would start to just explore their services, what actually they have just exposed. And we will be just consuming those services, and then we'll be sending the data to them so that, right, like those services can be accessed and can be make use of it. And then finally, like we would be just paying it only for the paper usage. It means whatever the amount of usage we have done, or the whatever the amount of data that we have just sent it over, that by calling those services, we will be just paying it for that kind of. It's all about like, for the first question, like I am not familiar with the cloud, and for the second question, like I am not familiar with the list of services which are available within the cloud, or even the third question, like I know something about Azure cloud, or I know something about Google cloud, I'm not sure about this Amazon web services, cloud services means. So everywhere, like only the name is getting changed, okay? And end of the day, what is actually there in the cloud is they have the infrastructure. Infrastructure means here the physical servers in place in some other region, okay, which actually we are making use of it from an infrastructure as a service point of view. And when it comes for the platform as a service, as well as from the software as a service standpoint, they have installed some of the softwares on their physical machines, and they are just exposing those softwares or platforms to us in the form of a service, in the form of a HTTP URL in the browser, so that, right, we could be able to hit that from our end user browser, and we could be able to access those services. That's what is actually happening in the cloud. So they have the physical infrastructure, which they're calling it as IaaS, infrastructure as a service, which they are exposing it to us for consumption. As well as they have the platform as a, they are exposing platform as a service and the software as a service in the form of APIs, application programming interfaces, which are nothing else. The from a layman point of view, from a programmer developer point of view, like it's nothing else the list of methods what actually a particular class is having it, that particular service class is having it, and what are, and based on the necessity, we have to make use of it. So for example, if it's going to be a database server, which we are going to make use of it in the cloud, then we may do four operations at the max: creation of the data, retrieval of the data, or selecting the data from the database tables, as well as we may be just updating the existing database tables, or we might be deleting some of the data from the tables. So these are all the four operations we might be performing. So for that instance, for this example, actually, like the cloud providers like AWS or Azure or GCP, Google Cloud Platform, they might have just exposed 4 methods to us, like do delete or do select or something like a do insert or something like a do update. And within the method parameters, like they will be just asking us to pass the input parameters from our end so that, right, the target database table gets updated in the cloud. So this is how actually these list of method signatures, which will be exposed for us to us for the consumption, is called as the application programming interface. And the overall, the communication here, the communication protocol is HTTP. Yes. HTTPS or HTTP. If it's going to be public, then it would be HTTP. If it's going to be on a secured network, then it would be something like HTTPS, where actually we have to log in to access these cloud services. And once after we log into these services, we can select our own set of services. For example, here in this diagram, right, each and every icon is going to serve a particular need. It's not mandatory that all these list of icons should be used for the IoT applications, or not only for specific to IoT applications, to any sort of web application or desktop applications or even just contact or just writing some sort of software for our with respect to the embedded layer, whatever it might be, they have exposed, or even with respect to some of the services which are exposed specific to big data, analytics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, for all these needs, each and every cloud provider, similar to Amazon, they have exposed their own services in the form of list of method operations, methods or operations which can be consumed by us. We are not going to do any sort of implementation to call those methods, and then we are going to pass the input parameters, and then later actually we would be getting the response back from them. So that's how actually the cloud services has to be visualized. So if you are new to cloud, don't worry, cloud is nothing else a physical infrastructure. If you are new to this list of cloud services, you know something about cloud, you are new to this cloud services, then cloud services are nothing else, just they have written some sort of program and they have installed some softwares which they are exposing it to us in the form of, in a colloquial layman point of view, the term is list of operations or methods being exposed. But from a technical standpoint, like we used to call it as application programming interfaces, which are so-called APIs. Okay, so and the communication protocol with the cloud services are going to be HTTP. And if it's going to be secured, then it is going to be HTTPS. Secured means like once after login only you'll be able to just see their list of services, else you won't be able to. If it's going to be normal HTTP without secured means, then it's available for the public to access so that everyone can just access it. So, and then here actually the web services, they are exposing their cloud services over the internet, over the web. So that's the reason it's called as web services. And these web services, actually how they might have built their applications is like, they might have built using two type of web services. One is going to be SOAP. You might have come across this protocol, SOAP protocol. And the next one is REST protocol. The first SOAP protocol is Simple Object Access Protocol. Simple Object Access Protocol is much more secured than the REST protocol. And this REST and this SOAP protocol, there is a limitation called as it always can understand only the data format. XML is the only allowable data format for SOAP protocol, which has been used in the earlier ages. But now this REST, which is going to be representational state transfer, as its name suggests, it's going to be a representational, it's going to be a structure of value, okay, in a simple terms, a collection of data in the form of JSON format or else in an XML format, which will be just passed over this HTTP, and it reaches those services, and we are consuming those services and we are pushing the data, and they would be just collecting our request, and they'll be processing it further, and they'll take it forward for next actions based on our need. So on a high level, like this is what is all about cloud. And here each and every small icons are several services. So if I get a requirement for IoT, for example, as someone suggested, like Nidhi, I came to understand that they were trying to, once after user logs in, so in their case, like a login is required. So the underlying protocol for the web services should be HTTPS. Okay, so it's going to be secured. Once after the end user gets authenticated, then they will be allowed to access our list of services. For example, here we have around in the left hand side of this IoT application block, I have around six to eight services which are being exposed by AWS, and her requirement is like my user should be allowed to access only 4 or 3 out of these services. Means by the time like the authorization will come into picture, the authorization is nothing else allowing or else like a specific set of permissions given for that particular end user. So that actually like it can be defined within this AWS cloud via configurations, so that right it will be easier, or else we can store this information for this user X. These are all the list of services which can be accessed, something like that. We can just put it in a database so that accordingly, right, like they can just access our services. And if in case they don't have the access to that particular service, then we would be just throwing an error message saying like they are not allowed to access these services, and we would be throwing the message forbidden. Forbidden means no access, they don't have the access, they have to get the access from us. And for dynamic routing, I suggested to have it in the database or else in a NoSQL database. So it means like NoSQL database compared to databases, like a database will have a defined structure and it won't accept JSON formats. But in the case of NoSQL, we can have the structures in the form of JSON, and then we can store those JSON requests in the database directly in the form of documents. So that's the reason we will go for NoSQL. Here I suggested a solution to put it in the database. Why means, just assume that my user has just logged in now and they are doing some operation and she wants to just do a dynamic routing. Now I can just log into my database as an administrator and I can just give any sort of dynamic logging, dynamic permissions, so that right, when the end user's request comes for the next time, immediately it will be just reflecting there. That is one way of just doing the routes by storing the values in database. But other than that, if the real requirement is to have a dynamic routing during the runtime means immediately it has to get reflected, means yes, there are some options like rule engines in the IT industry. Some of the examples are drools, and then rule engines like JBPM and all. So you can just make use of those. You can configure the rules there dynamically. So based on the input from the end user,
sir, all of a sudden there is a discontinuity with the audio, sir. Muthuraman sir, Muthunarayanan sir, there is a discontinuity with the audio. Muthunarayanan sir, we couldn't hear you, sir. Kindly check at your end, sir, audio quality. Muthunarayanan sir, yeah, due to audio this power failure, again discontinuity with the resource person. Just bear with us for another 2 minutes. He'll be connecting back. Yeah, shall we continue with that activity? Types of sensors available in the mobile. I request participants to take part in this ice-breaking session. So within 2 or 3 minutes, again, he'll be connecting us. Due to power failure, quite often the discontinuity happens. So meanwhile, I request you to use the chat window for the type of sensors used in mobile device. Smartphone, we say, no? What are all the types of sensors available that you can start with? We hear from you. IR sensor, thank you. Temperature sensor. Morning itself, there are 2-3 sensors you all have mentioned. Is there any other sensors? 4-5 sensors. Camera, accelerometer. Accelerometer is useful for whenever we are flipping that mobile orientation, portrait or landscape. So for that it is useful. Yeah, camera. There is a sensor with a mobile also and all the cameras also. Ultrasonic sensor. Yeah, fine. Thank you. All the collections. Only one more is there. Acoustic, temperature sensor, voice recorder. Voice recorder sensor is available. I'm not sure. Gyro sensor. Fine. Only one more sensor I'm expecting eagerly. In my mobile, that if you, light sensor, proximity sensor. It will use based on that if it goes near to the ears, then it will... switch off, put off the light, and depending upon the intensity of the light, this all will be. Humidity sensor, fine, fantastic. There is only one more I'm expecting. That will be available with very few smartphones only. That might be the reason. Fingerprint sensor. In my mobile, I'm using fingerprint. So fingerprint sensor for fingerprint reading. So majorly, these are all the types of sensor, motion sensors, environment sensors, proximity sensors, so smartphone, accelerometer, yeah, ambient light sensor. Thank you for many of you giving the answer. Ambient sensor, ambient temperature sensor, humidity sensor, barometer sensor for pressure gauging, fingerprint sensor, gyroscopy sensor. This is harmful radiation sensor only for special persons. It is exclusively for only few member with the order, with the license they are designing. This is not with all the common mobile it is available. Magnetometer, compass, so all the directions it will give us. Then NFC sensor is for communicating device to device. Whenever we are paying money, if we keep our mobile, then mobile will communicate with that payment device. Then it will start communicating all the types of requirements for the payment or device-to-device communication. Whenever it is in the need of device-to-device communication, then it comes into the picture. NFC sensor. Let me check. Yeah, our resource person has joined us again. Welcome, sir.
Hi, hello, madam. Again, sorry, power failure.
Yeah, it's okay, sir. Okay. I'll stop the some ice-breaking session. We were playing with whatever the sensors available in the mobile. Everyone taken part. Everyone have given nice answer. Thank you all.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, ma'am. Yes. So, yep. So Humor is just having some questions on this cloud as well as... cloud services, right? It's very simple. If you might have not just got exposed to this cloud, it's very pretty much easy as well as it's very, very, like if you just spend some good time in getting to know about this, don't go just very too much into this cloud. Just look into the dashboard and just go and click on this IoT services, which are all available, and then have a look into each and every service. A clear description will be given for each and every service in the AWS, it means the dashboard itself. So based on our requirement, based on our need, we can just choose our own services. So let's get into some of the services here. So here you can just see here, there is a IoT service, which I am just This SQS is specifically for queuing the service. For example, like if I want to just query some data similar to a database, I'll be going for this SQS in order to just to put some queue. I'll be having a queue where actually, like if I want to push the messages as action, like I want to just push it at the back end. Like for example, like when we were just pushing some messages via email or text messages, then we'll be putting in this particular SQS queue, simple queue service, or else a simple query service, which will be just interacting with our IoT applications. And then later, as an outcome, like they will be just sending alerts via this simple notification service as a text message, as well as simple email services via an email. So we can just configure it our requirement. And as a whole, like this AWS cloud, right? Like when we are into the cloud, they used to just mention it via this icon. And then within that, like this VPC is a virtual private connectivity network, which actually any cloud service, any cloud service provider would be just giving it to us. That is what is going to be the login for us. So it means like we are into our private cloud, into our own private cloud. And if we want this, yes, it can be shared as a public or to some set of shared list of users alone. That can be done. So if I'm just keeping my IoT application here, here I do have some other components like KMS, Cognito, API gateway. So everything AMS is for secret key match, as well as this Cognito. And this API gateway will be acting as a filter application of APIs to the cloud. So it will be just check, it will do the first level check whether we are a valid request or not. Then only it will be just permitting us to get into the gate, into the applications. For example, like if we are just writing an application, IoT application, and if we are exposing it as a private one, then every time we will be just allowing them to go only via the gateway. If in case it's not going via the gateway, then in the gateway, I will be doing this authentication as well as this authorization stuff. And even before hitting my IoT application, I will be doing all these preliminary checks so that, right, it completely avoids the overloading of my application. It means like unnecessary complications. Cisco actually has to, this is the MySQL DB, this is the database system, and S3 is going to be again a data storage service, accepting not only the table records kind of, like for that we will be having this RDS. For S3, even we can just store the files in the form of files, in the form of HTML, in the form of CSS, in the form of images, whatever we want, we can just store it. So this S3 is a storage. And actually this AWS, they have just provided intelligence called as Lambda programming. So this is actually, they used to call it as functional programming. So based on my own need, even we might have just heard about this functional programming in MATLAB. Like we might be just dragging and dropping in the Simulink, and then we'll be configuring an expression that would again will be based on the input and output that would get executed every time and will be just giving us the desired output. So that's how actually in within the AWS services scope, Lambda is the one similar to that. And yeah, and we do have this machine learning connected here. Like this machine learning component will be collecting all the data from our IoT applications, and then it will be just doing some sort of analytics by applying the machine learning. Machine learning is kind of programming, and then on top of the concept here is like artificial intelligence. Like we'll be applying the artificial intelligence either in the form of a supervised learning or else in the form of unsupervised learning. So based on that, like we'll be designing this machine learning component, and we'll be configuring it here. And monitoring the overall IoT application, there are two components in AWS, like Cloud Trail and Cloud Watch. This will be doing the monitoring and logging of each and every request and responses which are being received by all these services into the AWS cloud, as well like it will be logging even the responses which are going out from the services. So this is how actually the IoT sit cloud. So the IoT list, what is the takeaway point here is, It doesn't needs to write a separate queue service. It doesn't needs to write a separate email service. It doesn't needs to write a it doesn't needs authentication and authorization as somebody else asks. Like, we can just give that role to API gateway. No need to worry about it. This API gateway will decide and it will do the dynamic routing and work on it in this gateway in the AWS. So it's kind of like previously when I was doing some sort of when I was a kind of a developer, by that time when I was developing these IoT applications, by the time these services not there and we have to write the code explicitly for each and every service, and we will be calling it from the application here and there based on my need. But in digital world, everything is in a configurable manner. It means like the world is moving complete code at all, kind of. Please don't write. If you write something, possibility is there like we may introduce issues or defects. So instead, Azure, they are just writing the necessary parts for us, and they are just exposing each and every components in the form of services, so that right, we can just come only with our business idea, and then we can just configure it by each and every respect services, whichever is our requirement. Thereafter, like we get live, it's very very easy. Now we cut the path. Okay, so that is what the takeaway point. So if in case like you are pretty much familiar, if you are not pretty much familiar and you are going to be first time user to build an IoT application in the cloud, no need to worry at all. It's all, you are going to input some code. So understanding right. Actually, I just taken a sample to explain all these services. It's all about again the same services. Set of services. Case now there is telling. I just tried out the sample use case. Something that I'm going to explain it here. Application requirement is connected vehicles, whether so that right I can track them very easily. For example, you can take it something like Uber or Ola, whatever it may be. Or else, let's assume something like we have some 100 or 200 cars. Okay. In each and every car, I have my own IoT device. I just fixed that hardware. And on top of that particular device hardware, we do have a firmware which can just talk to the internet. And by sitting in the, it means like as an administrator for this application, sitting somewhere in the world, I can control the data. It means I can just have a control over each and every car. What is the fuel status? What is the kilometers? If that particular car owner, if he's not willing to take up any of the trip, he can decline it. He can cancel that trip so that no, it gets automatically assigned to the next cars. So kind of whatever might be the business case, we can just apply it here. Something here I have something like connected vehicles. Okay, connected vehicle to just design. It means like a sample use case with AWS IoT. So I have this application implemented in AWS IoT. And why this AWS IoT means like this is actually not a programming language. Okay, programming this AWS IoT again is a service what has been exposed to me in the form of a REST service. So I can just consume it and then I can pass my values to them. It will be just replying me back with a response. So what would be the programming language here? There isn't any question at all regarding the programming language. You can .NET, MATLAB. This AWS or else Azure or GCP, they give provision for all set of programming language to get integrated with their services. It's all about only you're going to consume their services. Everything is that, like your programming language as well as your applications to have the knowledge to talk over HTTP. So now is everything is happening via web. So this AWS IoT is a separate service which comes again in part of IoT related functions like protocol transformation, data transformation. If you want to transform a data from XML to JSON, then there is a separate service there. Call that service, and then within that service you will have methods like XML to JSON, JSON to XML, or Java to JSON, whatever it you want. Everything is there. They are pretty much exposed to us to make use of it, and then pay per usage. They are giving it for free. Pay per usage, less cost. That's what actually we have to just go for it. Why? Means we cannot buy a separate infrastructure to buy application server or a web server or kind of a separate machine to install the Linux and all. Instead, like we are also getting benefited in that way. In the other way, like from us for making use of it. I have a AWS program which is equal MATLAB functions. Any set of functions here. So we can write it on our own based on our need. But the functions, and then finally, and you want to application to show it end user, the files which will be publication screens will remain the same, right? So I'll be storing Amazon S3 in the form of HTML and CSS files, so that Java can very easily. So kind of like I am going to even developing the IoT application itself, they are giving a lot of features by exposing a lot of internal methods such as within this AWS IoT component. So that's how actually it works. And then if I want to just push the notifications or alerts based on the events from one device to other, it is under SMS gateways. That's what this Amazon SNS is. Here you can see, right, connected vehicles, just in time registration means immediately they are registering it. I'm just arriving at the airport. I don't have this Ola app till this time with me. Registered via validation and all via our phone, and then immediately like it calls. I'm just booking a journey now. The journey reality is being called, and my data is being stored in the database. And then again, immediately, like my trip starts. And then for analytics purpose, like we will be having this kinesis and all, which will be collecting how many registered Ola app or Uber app. Analytics, and then finally, like we'll be to improve the customer satisfaction survey as well as sending the reports to our higher management. More number of cars are really required. They are actually like we are not able to serve. So why don't we just be done in the big data end? So this big data, either we can go big data is a concept within that, like here this the API is what has been exposed for big data is Kinesis by Amazon, and I do have this Lambda programming here. So here all these files will be transferred to this database in the form of HDFS, as you might have just heard about if you are familiar with big data. So that's how it transfers. So yeah, with this understanding, like cloud is nothing else, as I said, an infrastructure exposing which is exposing all sort of services with all sort of our necessary plugins. Like let us put it in this way, like all these sort of plugins or services being exposed, similar matching for time. They are just improving, adding up a lot of icon, like a lot of plugins for us to, so that, right, they reduce the lines of code what actually we are writing it on our same here as well. Okay. Okay. Now let's, with the understanding of these cloud related services, now let us just get into a particular, it means like now let's look into a topic where actually like whatever might be the IoT requirement, what are all the major steps, or else what are all the major areas actually I need to be very much keen as well as very much careful. Okay, that's what actually we are going to learn now for the next 30 minutes. That's what I just given the topic as, come let us design an IoT product. Okay, whatever might be the need of IoT and IoT product, it means like even before like to just start with this, I'm not going to tell any story, no worries. Like I'm going to share my architect experience. Okay, whatever in practice in the industry is, right, where actually we are just designing and architecting as well as a lot of enterprise products. Okay, what actually our experience, what we have learned from our experiences, first of all, don't immediately just go and just start doing the code implementation if you are familiar with any of these particular areas. Okay, first of all, just think on a very enterprise level. Okay, enterprise level, if at all it's going to be a small requirement of just writing a program for a sensor to just get the value of thermostat. Okay, even though it's going to be that much small, no issues at all, just think from all sort of design perspective and architecture perspective. Then later, once after you finalize, these are all the list of software stack which I'm going to use it for this particular need, and these are all the list of, I'm going to use it to integrate and build my hardware. On top of it, these are all my OS. This is what my web service for this protocol transformation. And this is how actually it has to be used. These sort of design, or else I will simply put it as a complete brainstorming needs to be done before just start a single line of code. That in the industries, we make sure like we don't fail, well, competitive enough competitors. Okay, both functionally as well as technically, we used to do n number of analysis. Yep. And after that, like a requirement is in my hand, now it's time for just more amount of time, architecture and design and implementation. In practice, that's what actually we are just following on. But actually, that is my role is on daily basis. Like whatever might be our customer's requirement, we have to just think through all the boundary conditions even before just designing. There are a lot of bound. We have to think through on that product. Code implementation, right? If you just mock UOM unified language or are in some other form like this agile and other stuff, so they say like no need of proper documentation at all, just draw a picture, take a screenshot while phone, send it to me, kind of was the process. Now agile specifications in the form of diagrams to my their technical ability, just to do my designing. These are all the areas that needs to be concentrated on. It failovers, everything will be writing the code. Code implementation is give it in the form of a specific application document to them. So with that, actually, they retain pointers, okay, product. Okay. So the thing is like object first strategy, not adapting an object first strategy. So what is this all about is, and then trying to fit IoT object to, yeah. So actually what running, and we are just doing an app application. Existing code implementation means at some point in your code implementation, again you have to just you will face some sort of situation deadlock, so that you won't be able to actually this particular principle comes into picture. They say yes, okay, you know well that are the device and get the specific list of values or the collection of or the structure of the this guy is having it in hand for the device X. Okay, what are all the information, pass it on to the device Y. So that actually let us just do and let us sit and map very clearly of inputs has to be mapped to the protocol B, which is CPI. That actually like we have to map it very clearly. Okay, this particular value, it has to get mapped with the, what is the equivalent of that rising temperature in very clear. That's what we are saying, like object first means what you come in network, just keep it very clean, so that right you have to just build your application once after only finalizing this object first strategy, so that right even while just designing this object first strategy, what has to be kept in mind very clearly is whenever you design a object first strategy, from a layman point of view, I will just say from a layman standpoint, bus what I am going to send it from device A, it has to be understandable by device B. That's it. This is what the layman term. So for that, what are all the things I need to do? I have to just map these inputs between these two devices. That is the major thing. Okay. By keeping that in mind, immediately the developer or us, we should not go and start doing the code implementation. Instead, right, we should think about, okay, today I'm having the 10 parameters. Tomorrow there might be some need like two or three parameters may get added up at some later point in time after a review or after Viva Voice or whatever it might be from an academic standpoint. Okay. So by that time, like we should have in a flexible manner. Okay. Only exact 10 indicators, have some placeholders for instead have some 2 to 3 additional parameters, which is of no use as of now. Let it be there in the contract. Okay. But what the class, you just send only that particular input as a request and add additional parameters. Then already you have a placeholder for that. So fill in those placeholder and then send those values as well along with the input parameters to the target system. So that's what we are calling it as a not adapting an object first strategy. Not at all thinking about the object, very keen to implement the need. That's it. Like, oh, okay, this is a carpooling system. The car will be getting out to pool. First, keep in mind what is going to be the input and what is going to be the what I am going to send output. That object pretty much cleanly defined. That's what then the design principle or the design the way sir, how actually we use why, the design
sir quite often little making bit voice a smart breaking thing is
just the
Muthuraman sir Muthunarayanan sir there is a
oh,
break
it, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Break in voice, sir.
There yeah, ma'am.
Sure. Yes, sir.
Okay, if again if it doesn't connect my LAN and then I can get connected. That is it clear, ma'am? If again the problem persists, just give me
it persists till now, sir. It is a break in voice is continuing, sir. Break-in voice is continuing.
Oh, is it? Okay. Okay, ma'am. Then can you just start? Okay.
Yes, sir. Log off, login can be done, sir. Otherwise.
Okay, ma'am. Just give me quick connect to my LAN. So until that time, you can continue with
sure, sir. Sure, sir.
Other activities.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sure, ma'am. Sure.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, ma'am. Thanks.
Yeah, sorry for the inconvenience today. Let us look at a few more use cases. From the morning, a lot of public utilization use cases they were discussing. I'll be focusing now on IoT in e-healthcare. So what are all the way medicinal practitioners are using the IoT and its importance? Lot of wearable technologies they have brought. So they'll be putting lot of monitors, sensors will be giving the indications. So through that they will be monitoring through visual plots. So the interpretation finally given to the doctors, that visual plot, how it goes, the pattern or time series analysis, these are all those things will come into picture. Through that, they will be interpreting lot of stuff. Next, finally, when it comes to medical products, it is mandatory to have analytics. Without analytics, it is very much tough to interpret by the medicinal practitioners, because mathematical interpretation and how that sensor gives that information or computerized information, it would be very tough. So finally, it will be put in the form of medicinal lingo. That can be the right word. So that artificial intelligence plays a vital role in it. Nowadays, IoT-based image-guided surgery is happening. So every nook and corner, the images will be given. Through that image, they will be understanding the particular region or affected area. Especially laparoscopy surgery, it goes fully with the IoT-based image-guided surgery. So they will be inserting camera into the affected location. So it will be monitored through that camera, every activity. That camera costly, that cost is also too high. But the through camera, they will be capturing a lot of images. Then robotic surgery, non-invasive, almost we can say the damage will become very minimal when it becomes robotic surgery. Than laparoscopy, it is much more better. The healing and the speedy recovery is also better. Then unnecessary tissues, not even MM level also, it will get corrected. So that robotic surgery people are trying with. Pulse oximeter, those days, very 100 years ago or 150 years ago, people used to check up the pulses through hands. The human expertise will be checking the pulse. Based on the pulse, they will be telling that this is the symptom or this is the kind of disease. Subsequently, instrument have been brought. Nowadays, this instrument, we ourselves can keep at our home. Even mobile, lot of apps have come. Whichever the mobile we have, that fingerprint based mobiles, if we keep our fingerprint based on that pulses, what the way tick will come in that fingertip. So based on that, it is giving pulse reading also. That level, that IoT reached to that extent. Pulse oximeter, virtual reality in surgery. Nowadays, completely the inner organ will be projected in terms of virtual augmented reality or virtual reality, so that so that surgery would become much more efficient. So this is the second method. Then next is microchips. So a lot of microchip have come. antibiotic level reading from the blood level, a certain limit of antibiotic dose will lead to a lot of other complications to the patients. Antibiotic is good for health. However, that level, threshold level should not exceed based on the patient's condition or blood level of the streaming, that level of medicinal streaming. So based on that, it gives that microchips gives the indication what level the particular patient need to be given the dose. So that is what the application. Yes, sir. Welcome back. Muthunarayana, sir. Welcome back. I have made you as a co-host. So this is yet another application. Yeah. Whenever there is a break comes, I'll come into the picture. Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I hope now the voice is clear.
Yes, sir. It is perfect now. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, ma'am. I'll start sharing my screen again. Okay. Yeah. So I hope that everyone could be able to see my screen now. Okay, so yeah, now actually this particular, the next three slides where actually I am going to just discuss, right? Let me just rephrase it again. Now, assume that each and every one of you has been assigned with an IoT architect role, okay? So what are your roles and responsibilities? In that way, I'll be driving the next three slides, okay? You are going to design an IoT product, like what has been just assigned to you. So what are all the design considerations that needs to be taken care before we design, before we arrive at a final design? So those are all the pointers, which actually I'm going to just cover it off now. And then just looking into this, not adapting an object first strategy, the takeaway point here is the input as well as the output, request as well as the response that needs to be defined at first before we start. Even before we start doing the code implementation, okay? What am I going to send from the device A? What actually device B is going to receive by that time? And what actually device B is going to respond back, which will be sent back to my device A? Intermediately, is there any necessary things that needs to be taken care while doing the data transformation or protocol transformation that needs to be taken more care? So that's what actually we will be just looking into it from an architecture and design standpoint. We being as the, it means myself and all, being as a senior technical architect, I have the role to just look into this object first strategy. So that's what we used to call. So define the contracts, define the requests and responses between the systems very clearly. And to be in the safer end, to make this system to be much more flexible, even to add some more additional input as well as the output parameters in the request and response, have some placeholders and in the contract so that you can make use of it at later point in time without doing, it means without having more amount of code changes when compared with the initial development. So that's what actually we used to go for object first strategy. And then the second strategy here is, second design consideration is making a smart thing just for the heck of it. This is what actually we will be doing it every time. For example, keep in mind that you are creating an IoT product to deliver value to your final users. It should never become a platform for you to showcase your advanced technical skills. So this is one of the major design consideration, which actually every one of us will be just making a flaw. Why means if I am pretty much familiar with some of the AWS services or some of the cloud services, or if I am pretty much familiar with some other concepts or some other tools or technologies, immediately I would suggest that particular tool would be the better choice to implement my requirement. Okay. That's what I am meaning it here. Make a smart thing just for the heck of it. It means what I know, I'll be just justifying as well as I'll be suggesting that this is what the better option or the better tools or the technologies to implement this requirement kind of. That should not be done at any point in time. That itself will be a big flaw. You have to analyze the requirement in such a way that based on each and every parameters, whether is my suggest, if I'm just suggesting some tool or tools or technologies, then I have to do a clean round of investigation during the design phase, comparing it with the competitors. It means like competitors means here the competition between the tools. Okay, I should not simply blindly use something like no, this can be done in Simulink, this can be done in MATLAB, no, we cannot just do it in Java, no, it can be done in Python and all. It's all about like we have to think what is really required for our requirement to implement the IoT product. So that's what is here. So that's what there this design consideration is. Always keep in mind that think about your end users. Okay, think about your end users. You might be an expertise in any of the technical skill areas, and then you may design a UI screen in such a way that you can understand, but you are not the end user. Okay, so you have to think in such a way from an end user's point of view, whether am I just understanding this kind of. Okay, so always just suggest any tools or technical functionalities, anything. You have to just think through it, and then you have to compare with it, its alternatives, choose the best approach, and then just go for it. Okay. And then the third one is not paying attention to scalability. So this is actually a huge one. This topic, right? The scalability. This one term, scalability, means it means a lot. It's very important that you can see here. Very important to be aware of the refresh cycle of the IoT setups. For example, if you are setting up some sort of an IoT application in the cloud, then as I said, like this API gateways, nodes or servers or workstations or device refresh rate, this has to be taken care pretty much in prior, not after completing the implementation or the development. Okay, for example, like you might be just expecting that if you are keeping the refresh cycle of a particular device to happen every 1 hour, just once in an hour, then if that's the case, then you have to just accommodate that particular refresh cycle so that right the system will get restarted again by that during that refresh cycle. So you cannot just expect the latest values again after the refresh cycle. So you should just consider each and every parameter, something like this, like a device refresh rate. If I'm just defining this device refresh rate, then I have to be pretty much careful, as well as I have to do some sort of background work before I reach this particular refresh cycle. For example, like the sensor is just keep on sending the values to the unit controllers, and these unit controllers are aggregating all the data together, and it's going to just push it to the system controller. So prior to that, like it would be always good to just persist the values or the data somewhere in a local storage, or else in the in-memory, so that right we make sure that if at all the system gets restarted due to if it gets restarted or if it gets refreshed, the latest data would be lost. So in that case, like it's better to just keep it in server location somewhere in the form of a local data, or else it would be better to just keep it in the database. So that's where actually this refresh cycle channel will come into picture while designing an IoT product. And here we need to think about scalability as well. Scalability mainly deals with, like for example, like I'm building an IoT application, I'm selling it in the market. Okay, because of my beautiful idea, my product is getting launched, and now I have almost around 20 customers. Okay, all of a sudden, due to its its excellence, the product's excellence, the customer base is getting increased, and from 20, I'm going to have around 20,000 customers, or else at least 200 customers. Customers means I should design my product in such a way that, or else I would, while designing itself, I need to just take care of the scalability as well. Scalability is nothing else. The end user, if the user base is going to get increased, my system should withstand whatever might be the load it's going to receive. It means the number of requests, whether my IoT product is capable of handling it. So these sort of questions only will be answering this scalability and all. Scalable means how much your application is scalable enough, how much you can just extend your user base, how much you can extend your it means like your software to adapt some more future changes within the product itself, kind of. That's what the scalability will come into picture. Okay, and then the fourth design consideration, what needs to be taken care is, we have to take more care on IoT UI designing. Okay, as I said earlier, like the UI designing is nothing else, your screen, your UI screens in the web application, which actually are going, which your end user is going to just view it in order to just view the ongoing measurements, as well as he is going to do the control, something like from an operator or administrator standpoint. So we have to think from their end. It's something not like you can see here, no, take more care while doing the IoT UI designs, as it may distract the end user to feel that your product is not lightweight and it's not very easy to use. Kind of, we should not give an impression that, even though like you might have just given a patternized idea and all at the back end in your product, if your UI is not going to be something like a user friendly, then for sure like your product is not going to get launched. It means like your product is not going to hit the market with at a very faster rate. Okay, you cannot do the competition, even though you have a patternized solution sitting at the back end. Okay, so this is what actually they are meaning it here, like the UI should not distract the end users. Like they should not get a feel like, yeah, wow, this is hectic, this is a lot of hectic, yeah, I am not able to follow where to go and just trigger the alerts, where to send the notification, or where to go and just change my room temperature and all. Simply these guys, they are given something on a high level, so I have to get used to it. Kind of, it should not be the fact. We have to design the UI in such a way that it's pretty much easier for the end users to make use of it. That's the takeaway point here. So these four pointers, right? Like, let me just put it on a very high level, in a very faster manner before moving on to the next one. So first, design the input, request, and output response very clearly based on the device's protocol and what are the devices they are going to communicate within themselves, and then map those request, input, and output parameters clearly in an Excel sheet, at least. Call it as a contract, and then make sure that is being followed. To be in a safer end on a scalability standpoint, like if you want to just have some additional parameters, put it as something like temp 1, temp 2, temp 3, and then leave it as it is as a placeholder, so that later you can fill it down with air temperature or cooling agent, whatever you want, okay, based on your business need, kind of, to keep it as a flexible one. And the next one is, by thinking something like, you know, I have only Java developers with me, so always I can do only Java applications, kind of, it should not be the case. Or else, I am pretty much familiar only with MATLAB. I would always suggest you to just go only with MATLAB, kind of, should not be the case. Select the tech tools and technologies based on the IoT products requirement, not based on your technical skills. That's what the takeaway point. And the third is, like, since we are dealing with the devices, right, hardware as well as the software, we need to think about refresh cycle, we need to think about their charging, battery charging. So everything, each and everything needs to be taken minute care, else, right, your battery may go down, your system might be completely out, even if you might have developed a pretty much high quality, high available pakka software. Okay, it's going to fail. And then the fourth one is, like, your UI has to be in a end user easy perspective for him to access. Just from a layman standpoint, your UI has to be else, even though you might have just given a patterned solution at the back end of your software, it's not going to work out. Okay, it has to be very, very lightweight, and that too, like, in real world for our IoT products, the end users will be like, we cannot expect engineers to be there sitting to do the operations as well as administrations. Okay, so for sure, like, that particular resource or the we have to give it to them from a layman standpoint, so that they understand and they operate the system very well. That's where our IoT product will click. Okay, then moving on to the next design consideration. Okay, so the next one is not understanding the precise functions. Yeah, as I said earlier, like, we have to take care of each and everything, because we are each and every parameters, because we are not just going to deal it's not something like a WhatsApp, or it's not going something like a Facebook, human to human interaction via software. Okay, this is all about a hardware talking to another hardware via a software. That's what we are calling it as IoT. Okay, so here actually, like, the speed of the particular motor or a generator, or the battery performance of a particular controller, and then overall longevity. Longevity means like how much a particular product can withstand, or else do we have necessary measures like if a fuse goes out in a particular device, okay, that device will be completely cut out from our communication. So what else we are going to respond back for our end users by the time? Like, are we going to say them that we got an issue, or else are we going to send them a message saying like, no, actually like server is rebooting kind of message, or else are we going to say them that, sorry for the inconvenience, we would be getting you back. We have registered your request in our queue. Your request will be processed in short period of time. So kind of like there are a lot of ways how we can express our responses back to them. So usually in our industries, like for industry softwares, what actually we are just designing and architecting, we won't be letting know the end users exactly what has happened at our at the target end. Okay, that's where actually like we won't be allowing them to just know the exact root cause. Instead, we would be just giving them some instruction saying like, we have received your request, so that right, like we are going to address your request shortly. Sorry for the inconvenience caused. We would get back to you. That's what actually we will be just giving it back to them. Okay, I think Rohit Patel, can you just remove those? Yeah, thanks Rohit. Okay, so this is how actually we need to take care of each and every precis functions. Okay, because we are going to design an IoT product. This is not a normal software, something like a chat application or something like a meeting application like Zoom or this Google Chat. Yes, something like that. Okay, and then glossing over the IoT security requirements. Key parameter for any of the software is security requirement. Okay, and that too for this IoT, we have to be very, very careful, as well as this particular IoT related security requirements has to be handled with fragile, like it has to be handled with more care. Why? Means here the human intervention is not going to be there after this software is being deployed or when it's running in production, right? Human intervention won't be there. Human intervention will be there only if there is a troubleshooting or an alarm or a notification is happening. Okay, if something is going wrong maliciously due to some software requirement, okay, if some hacker or if some intruders, if they are introducing some unnecessary request to our IoT products, okay, then it may reduce the overall performance of our product. Okay, so that may cause customers to get a feel that we are not responding to their request as quick as possible when compared with their past experiences. So this security is kind of a big topic which has to be handled with more care. So that's what actually we are just saying. And here overall the data level security is much more required. This is in the software level where actually we do this protocol transformation and all. We have to be pretty much careful while doing the transformation. We should not lose any data. Okay, and as well, like we have to transform the exact data what we have received from device A to the device B. And if there is a minute changes, for example, let me give a sample. You might have, these are some of the common errors which our developers will make, will be just usually just introducing. Okay, for example, rounding off issue. Okay, that guy will be giving my sensor, no? The thermostat guy will be giving me the temperature as. This guy in the software, no, he made a rounded it off 0.89 into 9. Okay, so that now it goes as 98.9 to the end device. That is actually wrong, because in other softwares, something like where it's related to booking an air ticket or booking booking a cinema ticket or a booking or something like a WhatsApp application or something like an online learning applications, some e-learning applications and all. These excuses can be given, but here actually we are talking about devices. Okay, the devices, we have to be pretty much careful and we have to keep it very precise. How many number of decimals, floating points, I have to just manage it after the decimal point. Kind of these things has to be very carefully handled. Okay, I just come across like most of our developers, they used to just round it off and then finally like even it may just result, it will give false results. It won't fail actually. It may give false results. For example, if any of you guys, like any, it's not any of you, like everyone might have been just familiar with this fuzzy. Okay. Just a minute. Okay. So everyone might have been just familiar with fuzzy, or somebody might have been familiar with fuzzy. If you just get into this fuzzy world, right, it's all about the value between 0 and 1. Kind of like here we have to take more care. Like it's not simply just to avoid the fourth decimal or the fifth decimal. Based on your software need, it means based on your device requirement, it has to be precisely constructed. And that particular data has to be pretty much secured enough while transferring it. Okay. Two things are there. One is that like data level security, and the next one is device level security. Data level security is on the data layer while transmitting the data over the transport layer security, TLS. It has to be taken more care, and or else if you are just transmitting it via Wi-Fi or via Bluetooth or via Zigbee, just make sure that it follows all these security protocols properly. And if it's going to be, it means via internet, then we have to take care on this IPv6 specifications and all. And secondly, like, okay, on this data level security, to make it much more secure, okay, it means like the network protocols are there to make sure that security is not breached. But if you want your applications to be much more secure, then in the application layer, you can do encryption and decryption. For example, you can do encryption using some of the hashing algorithms, okay, which you might have come across, so that right, that particular key can be passed on to your the device B via emails or via other mode of transportation, so that right, they use that particular security key while decrypting your complete message as well as the data. So that's how actually the security can be achieved. And when it comes for the device level security, again, the device level security means like your device, from a device standpoint, like it has to be pretty much secured in accessing. It means to prevent the access from unnecessary IPs. Only the defined set of IPs it should just allow us to operate. Kind of, it's all about network level security along with the device. So that's how actually it has to be. And then moving on to the next design consideration, considering endpoints to be the only that matters. It means like there is a proverb, don't talk to stranger. It's not actually a proverb. It's actually a design pattern, what has been just taught to us from the day one. When we start thinking about ourselves as an architect, it's nothing else. Don't talk to strangers. Unnecessarily, don't talk to any of the strangers. Okay. Let it do only its sole purpose precisely. If I am going to be a protocol converter, for example, protocolconverter.java or protocolconverter.py means I should do only the protocol conversion only. I should not do something X or Y within my protocolconverter.java, that particular class. So that's what actually we used to call it as don't talk to strangers. It means like do what has been assigned one and only for you. This is what actually we used to, this is how we used to design each and every classes. It will not have any other dependency. In the other way, it should not have any other dependencies within a particular class. A class A or class B should be written for its own specific need, and they can communicate within themselves if there is a further need, and there shouldn't be any dependency like class A cannot live independent of class B. That should not be the case. Okay. So. Yeah, Sheetal Vaishnav, I think you raised your hand. I will get back to you. Just give me 10 minutes. I will try to just cover the rest of the design principles. Then later we can have a discussion.
Sir, I request you to go to more and disable participant annotation. They are trying to annotate, so you can disable it, sir. Click the button more, where in which you can see disable participant annotation.
Yeah, that's fine, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
No, that's fine, ma'am. Like that is not just creating any issues for me. But anyway, like from our participant standpoint, that might be frustrating. Yeah. Thanks, ma'am. Yep. So this is what actually the design principle, which it talks all about. Don't talk to the strangers. Do whatever has been just assigned to you. This is how actually we used to talk to our classes. hey, do only your job. Don't go and just do others' job. So that you may think like you are creating dependency, but actually like you may be thrown out at some point in time if you are not doing only your job, kind of. So this is one of the main major design principle which we used to follow for IoT design. And then the next one is not keeping things simple and not creating value proportions. For example, like you can see, take more care on UI design. Overall UI needs to be at the top notch and all the operations should be user focused. Yeah, that's what actually, again, we are just coming back to the same design path in designing the UI, end user friendly, pretty much customizable, as well as it means from an user standpoint, it should be pretty much easier for them to understand. And even a layman, it means even an operator or an administrator, they should understand actually what it means and what is the reason for having a button here, or what is the reason they are showing the value here, and show it to them with each and every precise measurements in the numerical value, with each and every with their measurements as well. For example, if it's going to be liters, or if it's going to be something related to millimeter or centimeter, just put it very precisely and show it to them, so that makes the end user very happy, and then he would be just using it very it means like unnecessarily, like we should not have anything in the screen. That is the point, actually, take your point here. By thinking in a way like you are creating a very good thing, you should not just unnecessarily, you should not overburden the end user, like overburden your end user, something like go here, click here, help is there, that and all. Make it simple. Okay, that's the takeaway point here. And then moving on to the next one, not being aware of the data communications will take space. For example, IoT systems have to handle a huge amount of data. Okay, so how well it can be transferred, such as data needs to be taken care of. It means like if in case like IoT devices, right? Since the human interaction is not there, like the devices are going to just talk to each other via our software. If in case the sensor, right, the temperature sensor or some other chiller, water may get, water level may go down or water level may increase, something like that. So these things, you know, only with our previous history, we should not design our system. Okay, just by having the past history alone, we should not design any IoT product. Okay, you should be designing your product in such a way that you expect n number of requests, kind of. You have to just assume it, then only you have to design it. You should not just tell at times like, no, I will be receiving only one or two requests in 4 hours. In next 2 hours, possibly I may receive. So in a whole day, like I will be receiving only some 20 requests. No, make it your system, at least from a design standpoint, make it much more flexible to adapt. It should not be restricted to any magical number like 20 or 200. Just keep it much more flexible. Keep your design in such a way that it accepts even 2000 requests per second, kind of. So that's what actually we are talking it here. And mostly like keep your data, since we are going to just handle with huge amount of data. For example, like if you open a text file which has a lot of data, you won't be able to just exactly get any words. Like for example, if I just open my notepad, right, if I type something in a very faster manner, and then I have some around 1 lakh lines of some sentences being written. If I want to do a search, what I used to do, I'll put Control F, okay, and then I'll be searching for my search term. Like for example, if I'm searching for test means that occurrence should be there in 1000 places within that 1 lakh lines of thing, okay, which is kind of an unstructured manner. If you put the same data within an XML or a JSON, it means in a structured manner, you can get into that particular parent tag, and then you can access that child tag exactly without disturbing the others, so that the data searching, as well as the data what actually is required for us, can be accessed in a very faster rate. So that's what actually here we mean to say. Always keep your data in a structured fashion, as well as in order to just perform some actions on top of it. That's what we mean to say here. And then the next design principle is not paying attention to the unique requirements of the users. For example, like data staging and intermediate data processing needs to be considered. Always move the data to a centralized server or gateway for processing. So what actually we are saying is not paying attention to the unique requirements of users. end user screen has been built for some particular need to have a control over our devices, but actually in the same software web application, what actually we would do is like we would be just storing all sort of data in our database without thinking of archiving some part of data into some other archival database. Kind of, we won't be designing it. Instead, no, we won't be thinking it until unless the end user comes and report it to us saying like, "Boss, your applications are pretty much slow nowadays." Kind of, then only we will go and do the analysis. Why it went very slow? Kind of, then finally you will end up with the root cause, like your database is overloaded with because on a per day basis, like if it's loading around 1,000 records, for sure, like within 100 days, like 1 lakh records will be there. In next, for example, like in 1,000 days, it will become it will be just incrementing. It will be just loading incrementally, right? So accordingly, like that much amount of data will be there. So initially, like when you are when you just place a select query to fetch the data from database, it would be it would have just fetched you within milliseconds. By now, like because there were only 100 or 200 rows of data were there in my database tables, but now I do have 1 lakh data rows in my tables. So what actually has to be done? Kind of, you will start thinking about it by now. By that time only, that should not be the case. Design it properly. Just keep only the latest week data in your database. Okay. Prior to that, if it's more than a week, try to just push it or archive it to some historical database. Okay. It means to move the history data to another database and call it as an archival database. This actually in software, like we used to call it as housekeeping activities to make sure that our databases, our servers are completely flushed. It means archived or purged or deleted on the temporary files, as well as just moving the data from one place to another place. So that, right, always we make sure that our systems are pretty much ready enough for the end user to hit it and make use of it. Kind of, we will always maintain that. So that needs to be taken care. And then the major part is confusing quality control with testing. Okay. So think on quality from day one, not during the product that it is being tested. What actually it says is like, I think everyone might have been familiar with this topic. Don't think about doing the quality control at the last. Okay. When actually the product is being tested, don't think about the quality control during the test phase. Think about the quality control from day one, when you just start collecting the requirements as well as while designing the product everywhere. Let them just think about this quality control. Don't just go and think about this quality control. Oh my God, like it should have supported 10 users instead of 5, kind of, during the testing. That's the point here. So testing, the thought on the testing and alternative scenarios with some test data, everything has to be just prepared in parallel to your development as well, in designing and development. So that's what this particular point is. And then finally, like making subscription and sign in mandatory from the very outset. So create user manuals for familiar. Okay, what actually it says is like, you might have just seen some of the IoT products, like which might be from GE or Siemens or Samsung, whatever may be the IoT product, which you are just using it on your daily basis, or you might have come across, you might have seen, like they might have given their user manual in a very layman point of view, so that, right, each and every single user, end user, they should be understanding that particular user manual, and they should follow that. Kind of like they even for IoT products, right, we used to, like our companies, we used to just give n number of languages as well, the same user manual in different languages as well. Why? Means like the end user is our customer, is our God. So we always just make sure that our customer is happy with us. So that's what actually, if any subscription, any newer subscription, for him to just update the subscription or to pay for it, or else if anything is sign on is required, or it might be a very, very simple thing, like connecting different cords and wires, what I'm just providing along with the device, whatever may be the requirement, I have to give it in the user manual in a very pretty much straightforward manner, so that, right, it's very easier for our end users to understand as well as to make use of our IoT product. That's how actually it has to be designed. So these are all some of the I won't call it as design principles, like these are all design considerations that has to be mandatorily taken into account while you just design an IoT product. But other than these 12 pointers, actually these are all major pointers, Okay, other than these 12 pointers, still n number of parameters are there which we used to consider while designing a particular product. For example, we will be just considering the availability of the product. It means like availability means like we'll make sure that even though the battery is draining, okay, immediately like we might have just written some part of code to just intimate us that the battery is going to be drained in this many number of hours, kindly take care kind of notifications. Or else like we would be just having auto healing or auto recovery programs there, so that it replaces and it automatically it connects to the next battery automatically kind of. And then like we might be just like everywhere, right? Availability, maintainability, stability, and then the product has to be reliable in nature. And then from a failover standpoint, like it has to be like from an availability and failover standpoint, if any of the target systems or if any of the target devices are not reachable, immediately we won't respond back saying like no, that guy is not available. Instead, what actually we used to do is we will be just having some design patterns being implemented in the software, something acting like a electrical circuit breaker for us, so that right it will be just if for example if my target I'm just getting a input request from my device A, that particular request it has reached my software mediator software, and my software is going to send it to software device B. By the time my software is coming to understand that device B is completely down, so by the time like what actually like my software immediately will not respond back to device A saying like bus that device B is down, you cannot do anything, something like that. Instead, what we will be doing is we will do some retries there. Okay, we will try for the number of retries we used to configure it in our software, saying like try for 5 more times for every 5 minutes or for every 5 seconds. Okay, then only just respond back saying like the device is not available. Okay, so kind of like we will have failover mechanisms and retry mechanisms in place. So that's how actually we used to just design it. And other than that, like we will also be just taking more care in between the interaction of firmware as well as the software. And if any protocol conversion is required, we will be taking care, as well as even in the embedded layer, like unnecessarily, like we should not let out even a single resource, even from a hardware, as hardware means like from a dimension and the selection of the material, everything has to be taken care. And when it comes for the software, it's all about how fast it is, how much it's performant oriented, and how many requests it can handle at an instance, how much it's very much pretty much easy for the end user to understand my UI screens, and how it's user friendly, whether the user manual is clearly documented with simple steps for even a layman to understand this, whether my operator or administrator can understand all these and he can handle my device, kind of everywhere we used to think about it during the design, and then accordingly we'll be designing it. So that's where actually this is how actually we used to design our IoT products. And so with this actually like that's it. I have it for the day today. So for if you have any design or architecture or any programming queries, you can just post it to my email ID. You can make a note of it. And for any help and support, whatever you need, like you can just send it to our committee members, so that they can get back to me, and I can just address those queries accordingly. Overall, like thanks a lot everyone for keeping patience in listening to my discussion on this particular topic. Thanks a lot.
If you have any questions, participants, you can use chat window, or I will give the provision, unmute provision. You can keep continuing the QA session. I enabled unmute option. You can unmute yourself. You can come forward for the interaction session or QA session. Feedback form will be opened till 4 o'clock. Nothing to worry about feedback form. Link I have shared. So meanwhile, if you wish to have any communication or interaction with the resource person, you can continue. You were given the option to unmute yourself.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yep.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I just want to know any software tools is available for Arduino programming that connects with IoT devices. Because I am using RFID, tags with IoT devices, my project is there. So I want to know any software tool that is used for connecting Arduino with IoT devices, like child RFID tags that will be used in hospitals in foreign countries. Any software tools available there for connecting IoT? Thank you, ma'am. That's my question.
Okay, I can just note it down. Ma'am, you can just note it down and you can just pass it across. Like, I will try to just answer their questions. Specific questions.
Sir, they are using, audio note only, sir. Or through audio only, they are giving the questions, passing on. Then another question, they were asking for little bit hands-on practices or where to start and how to start, something like that, sir. They're expecting some light on hands-on side also.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's good to know, ma'am. That's good.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Anyone would like to have interaction through audio, the option is given. You can unmute yourself. You can interact with your questions or clarification.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, good evening, Dr. Sayed.
Sir, I wanted to know when the hands-on sessions are going to start.
Because I work with Arduino, but Raspberry Pi and NodeMCU, I'm eagerly waiting because both the hardware platforms are a little bit different. So any session related to that, could you please guide me?
Yeah, I think like... you have just placed your queries in the chat window, right? I think our management will be just getting back to you answering those questions.
Yeah, okay, fine, sir. Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yep, sure. Thanks, Dr. Sir. Yeah, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
If there isn't any questions,
yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you for your valuable contribution for the forenoon session as well as afternoon session, sir. Thank you, dear participants. Let us join tomorrow sharp by 10 o'clock. Tomorrow, the morning session starts by 10 o'clock, ends at 12:30 to 12:45. Afternoon session, every day, it starts by 2 o'clock and it ends by 3:45 to 4 or 4:15, depending upon the context of the resource person who they handle. So this is the day-wise agenda. Every day we may need to join in the morning session by 10 o'clock, afternoon session by 2 o'clock. So if there is any other questions related to, we will be ready to answer. Hands-on, since it is day one, hands-on sessions are postponed a little bit. So to give the overview of the complete STTP, today it has brought the architecture or product development or life cycle of the IoT products. This is what today it is addressed in the session. Keep waiting and you will be having a hands-on session in the forthcoming days. And tomorrow we will be having different resource person in the morning as well as in the afternoon, two different resource person tomorrow. Tomorrow afternoon, especially the resource person is brought from security point of view. Many, I could see you are eager to learn related to security, IoT with the security concerns. So you can keep interacting in the tomorrow's session with Mr. Navaneethan. So with that note, I'm concluding. Thank you, sir, for your acceptance and being with us and delivering the session throughout the day. Muthunarayanan sir, from the bottom of my heart and on behalf of CSE department at B.V. Raj Institute of Technology, we thank you, sir. We are looking forward for your kind support in the forthcoming sessions. Whatever we plan for in the CSE department, we will be in touch with you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, ma'am. Thanks, everyone, for your patience. As I said, get in touch with our our committee members, so that, right, like whatever may be the queries, like we'll get answered for you as well. Like as ma'am said, like yeah, they have just organized list of pretty much good topics where you can deep dive. This is actually an intro session, so where actually I want to just touch base on this IoT and other related design, how to design and other stuff. Overall, thanks a lot for your patience, thanks a lot for your help and support. Thanks madam, as well as thanks, thank you, thanks a lot the management, as well as a special thanks to Dr. Pichai, who has just contacted me for this. Thanks a lot overall.
Thank you sir, stay safe.
Yeah, thanks ma'am, I'm getting disconnected. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you sir.
Yeah, thanks everyone, bye bye.
Yeah, we all can leave from this session, today's session. Tomorrow onwards, so let us continue by 10 o'clock for the morning session, 2 o'clock for the afternoon session. Thank you all.